During the November 2021 producers letter, Vision Realms listed a number of changes that they've been working on for the combat system in Pantheon Rise of the Fallen. This has led to several articles on gaming journalism websites with titles like Pantheon Rise of the Fallen to completely overhaul combat, or Pantheon Rise of the Fallen will completely change combat. So, is this really a complete change, or just another case of journalism clickbait? Now, I gotta be honest, when I read this section of the November 2021 producer's letter, I didn't think it was that big of news. It seemed obvious that it was just another step of iterative game design until I saw these articles popping up about how combat is being completely changed, and the subsequent comments from people understandably confused why Vision Realms would undergo a complete overhaul at this stage. Now, if you find Pantheon's development process confusing, hit the subscribe button now because this channel is dedicated to following its development closely. I am not affiliated with Vision Realms. I've just been tracking the project for a long time, and I like to share what I learn to make it easier for you to track it with me. So why would I even address the reactions to these articles? There would be no point in me coming out and just saying that I wasn't surprised by these changes. And despite what some may say, I'm also not trying to suggest that Vision Realms always knows exactly what they're doing, because they don't. The troubles of Pantheon's history are very well documented, but it seems like many people have become so focused on that and always keeping an eye out for the next red flag that they've lost sight of everything else that's been well documented. And I think it's worth recalibrating our eyes by taking another look at the big picture. Let's start just 1 month earlier in the October 2021 producer's letter, where these changes were first hinted. Quote, "Our design goals for combat in Pantheon have always been to encourage and reward tactical choices, group synergy, and game knowledge. The importance of a player's equipment, the abilities they choose to bring into combat, and their management of resources over the span of a fight are critical to making combat in Pantheon feel fun and engaging, and we believe that we can do an even better job of realizing that gameplay promise than we have to date." So far, I'm not sure I would call that a complete change. Without getting too pedantic, if those specific goals are already established, then it sounds more like just working toward those goals. But just to be sure, let's look at the four specific areas of combat changes one by one as they are listed in the November 2021 producer's letter. Ability adjustments, attribute and stat adjustments, class identity, and difficulty adjustments. Starting with ability adjustments. Quote, "We've previously communicated that our vision for combat in Pantheon is one that steers away from the rotation-based approach that is so pervasive in tab-targeting MMORPGs, and instead encourages tactical decision-making, teamwork, and conscientious resource management. Nearly all of our class resources, ability costs, cooldowns, and potencies are being adjusted to better meet this vision," end quote. So again, this isn't a complete overhaul. These are adjustments to the numbers to get even closer to that overall goal for combat. And just in case you think they're lying about previously communicating this vision.
Is it not the case that when you reach max level, when you go and you look at a character guide, a class guide, are you not looking up, what's my rotation? What buttons do I hit every time in the same order to maximize my output? And I think, again, sometimes pushback on something like a limited action set tends to try and hold up the superiority of having all my abilities available to me. But when the end result is rotation, that is not super compelling to me.
I think the reality is that if it was more actiony, you wouldn't have the time to make the tactical decisions you're going to be needing to make, which abilities to use, what are your party members doing. It's just much more involved and much more tactical, and so that's why you've got that time to make those decisions.
Moving on to attribute and stat adjustments, the producer's letter says, quote, the importance of individual stats in Pantheon, be they core attributes, skills, or other modifiers, is paramount to creating the iconic and desirable itemization model we have in mind. Individual point gains should feel like a noticeable improvement, and the tighter we constrain those numbers while enhancing their effects, the more we can ensure that loot maintains value and longevity. We have overhauled these aspects of the game to create better clarity in what individual attributes contribute to, and to promote desirability in attributes that may not otherwise be considered core to a given class, end quote. This is the only time in the producer's letter where the word overhaul is used, and it's in reference to creating better clarity and to promote desirability. Even if many numbers were changed, which they probably were, it's still a step in the same direction rather than a complete change in direction. Making individual stat points meaningful has been a long time goal for Pantheon. In March 2018, Vision Realms released an article called Armor 101, and in it, creative director Chris Joppa Perkins said, quote, we want to introduce stats slowly and make each point of increase impactful. To this end, a bit over a year ago, we cut our base attribute amounts from the standard 80 down to 8. Going from 8 to 10 strength is a big deal, and we want it to feel like a big deal for your player's power and performance. So yes, lower level gear will have stats. Starting around level 6 to 8, you may find your first piece of armor with a +1 on it, but that +1 will be meaningful, and our goal is to make each piece you get after that feel like a genuine improvement, end quote. And as an example of how iterative this design process is, in May 2020, they announced that base starting stats were lowered again to further emphasize the importance of each individual stat point.
We have lowered all of this player starting attributes from 8 to 1. And that's pre-racial bonus, that's pre the spending of the character creation points that you get. All characters now, by design, start with 1 in each attribute, and then different races will have, as we know, the different attribute bonuses, and then you'll have some points to spend. But keeping those numbers low.
Even encouraging classes to diversify their stats in ways that you wouldn't normally think of is also not entirely a new idea.
We're keeping that intact, that sense of progression through the armor type. So yeah, as a warrior, you would want to be, you know, reaching for that leather when you're in cloth, and the mail when you're in leather, and the plate when you're in mail. You want to move down that line. Whether there will be exceptions to that, I love exceptions to norms. I love those edge cases. So expect there to be things like that. Whether it's through an unexpected attribute priority, where you would think as a warrior, I was just strength, stamina, all the way. Just you've got obviously agility and dexterity, which kind of live in this secondarily preferable world. But then you would never think of, you know, intelligence or wisdom or something like that as playing a role. But I mean, yeah, those edge cases are really cool. I think they breathe a lot of life into these games. Because they break norms, and you got to keep an eye on that, and it can't be just this cacophony of just ridiculousness everywhere. But I think when you establish a really good set of norms and standards to build the skeleton and the framework of your game, then you can break those rules in really effective ways, really interesting ways. So,
okay, so I'm going to be a human shaman.
Yep. I don't consider myself able to give formal legal advice on attribute, how you spend your attribute points. But what I could suggest is throwing a point into constitution, a point into stamina, and a couple points into wisdom, perhaps. We can talk later in the stream about kind of what those things do. It's not the only three stats that shaman need and benefit from, but it's a good place to start.
I would just do strength and intelligence, but that's just me.
All right,
actually, intelligence is very helpful. Intelligence for a priest class, wisdom is going to govern your spell power and your mana pool. Intelligence is going to govern your critical chance with spells, okay. And vice versa. For a caster, intelligence is going to govern your spell power, mana pool, and wisdom will govern your critical chance with spells.
I say something tongue-in-cheek. It turns out to be a real thing. This is cool.
By the way, if you're wondering how I found all these clips from so long ago, check out the Library of Pantheon, which is a website I helped make where you can easily find direct links to everything Visionary Realms has ever said about Pantheon. I can't blame anyone for not remembering everything the devs have ever said. It's a lot, but that's why my team and I made these resources available to you so you can avoid the embarrassment of going on Facebook or the forums and exclaiming that Pantheon is scrapping their combat system or abandoning Brad's vision when it's been well established that this has been the direction of combat for years. All of the past information is all right there. It's free and it's independently curated. So visit www.libraryofpantheon.com to refresh your memory or maybe even discover some things you never even knew. But anyway, the third topic in the November 2021 producer's letter is class identity. Quote, having distinct classes with their own strengths and weaknesses is a core tenet of Pantheon's development, and our combat improvements will allow us to explore the depth of those differences more than ever. Feeding off the changes to our attributes and skills, we are able to better specify where our classes excel over others, end quote. Class identity is indeed one of the original and deepest running tenets of Pantheon, so this too can't be considered a complete overhaul. The class identities and roles are fundamentally the same, they're just more clearly defined. The producer's letter even gives an example of this. Quote, wizards, though undisputed masters of direct damage, may find that not only are their debuffing spells fewer, but that they don't land quite as reliably as an enchanter's, end quote. Lastly, the producer's letter outlines changes to difficulty. Quote, players and enemies alike will now receive base power increases with levels gained. Coupled with our enhancements to attributes, players should feel that they are better able to meet the growing challenges of the game as they level, end quote. Now, I want to pause right here because just in case you might have interpreted this as meaning that NPCs will automatically scale their difficulty to always be an even match for you, let's put that to bed real quick with this quote from Joppa in the unofficial Pantheon Discord. Quote, that's not the same thing as level scaling mobs, which many would interpret to mean mobs will automatically scale their levels up or down to match yours. That's gross and will never happen here, end quote. The producer's letter goes on to say, quote, as a result of these adjustments, we've also redefined our target difficulty levels for different group sizes. Our intent is that players should feel the world and their options expand as they grow, yet always feel incentivized to form teams to take on challenges greater than themselves and be rewarded for doing so. These changes allow us to better achieve both aspects of that vision, end quote. Yet again, the goal for players to, quote, feel the world and their options expand as they grow, yet always feel incentivized to form teams to take on challenges greater than themselves and be rewarded for doing so, end quote, is as old as Pantheon itself.
And it's really all about teamwork. I mean, for those of you who haven't played an MMO like this, but you play cooperatively, you know, maybe in Call of Duty or in a MOBA or something, and you really enjoyed that experience of working together with your friends, developing the right tactics, Pantheon is bringing that back in a persistent way, where you can log in, play a few hours cooperatively against the environment, have a great time, build up your character, find some new items, earn new skills, and then take a break and log in a couple days later and continue on. It's not session based. It's a persistent game where you're building up your characters, like I said, over months and years.
And as such, yet again, these changes in difficulty are simply to better fulfill that existing vision, not experiment with something totally new. You might be noticing a trend here. As for how close to that vision they've gotten, well, I'll let you know the next time I have an opportunity to stream the game. Now, I want to mention that I totally understand that if you hear the word overhaul too many times, it stops seeming like an exciting thing. If you didn't know any better, it might seem like the devs are just taking shots in the dark, and that wouldn't exactly be exciting. So maybe Vision Realms should come up with a better way to describe what they're doing, not to mention the journalists being more careful about not misleading people by saying things like complete change. Because these combat changes are a far cry from 2015, for example, when Pantheon's design was truly overhauled and taken in a completely new direction. As we can see by the clips I've outlined in this video, these latest adjustments are steps toward the same goals that they've been pursuing since then. Just because you didn't see something coming doesn't necessarily mean it's coming out of nowhere. To say these latest changes are some major sudden shift is missing a huge part of the story. And again, since the whole story's already been laid out in the Library of Pantheon, there's not really any excuse to be missing parts of the story anymore. Now, this probably wouldn't be so much of an issue if it weren't for the fact that we MMO players have become so used to being disappointed that we are too quick to jump to conclusions and assume that everything we like about a game is just going to be suddenly ripped out from under us. But when you do that, when you have a knee-jerk reaction to a sensationalized title and assume that it means that they're gonna abandon their original vision or are just going around in circles, seriously, who are you helping? I'm not saying you shouldn't keep an eye out for red flags. Keeping an eye out for red flags is what caused myself and a group of other community members to press Visionary Realms for answers about what happened with Project Fairthale, ultimately leading to the October 2020 newsletter, which revealed that the game's codebase had undergone an actual overhaul. But looking for red flags is only productive like that if it's done carefully and in context with everything else. And when taken in context, this so-called major combat overhaul is really just another step of iterative game design. If you've never designed something before, it might be hard to imagine, but ideas regularly need to be evolved and deepened before they really accomplish what you want them to accomplish. And that doesn't happen by designers just sitting in a vacuum and talking about what they can fiddle with next. It comes with testing. As the October 2021 producer's letter said, quote, "Thanks to the data and feedback we've gathered from pre-alpha sessions and focus tests over the summer, our design team has identified a number of opportunities for improvements to the core combat experience in Pantheon," end quote. Let's not forget there are hundreds of real human beings logging into a real game, providing real feedback, which leads to real improvements. And remember that these improvements to the combat system happen concurrently with other development tasks. For example, game designers tweaking the numbers in the combat system doesn't affect the art team doing world building in Wild's End. I, for one, cannot wait until you can be a part of this process for yourself in Alpha and beyond. And if you want to track the progress on the Alpha to-do list, again, you can find that at www.libraryofpantheon.com. If you've been watching my videos for a while, you'll know that I never ask you to donate to Pantheon's crowdfunded development. Everyone has different financial situations and levels of risk tolerance, so what you do with your money is completely up to you. However, if you do make the decision to pledge, and my videos have in any way informed that decision, I'd appreciate it if you'd list me as a referral when you get your post-pledge survey. My account is bazgrimtv@gmail.com, and that just helps me know that I'm covering the things that you want to know about. I'd also love to keep in touch with you in the Bazgrim TV Discord channel. There's already a great group of people in there where we've been discussing all aspects of Pantheon, staying up to date on the latest news, and more. If you want to get in on that, the link for that will be in the description, or you can click on the card in the upper right now. I hope to see you there, and I also hope to see you in the next video.